The straight white man is film's most beloved character. This has been proved time and time again as male filmmakers have made movies about straight people for decades. A Birth of a Nation 1915 was the highest grossing film in America until another film that glorified Southern racism and heterosexuality just as much, Gone with the Wind, 1939, took its top spot. The movie industry has been a racist and homophobic industry since its creation. It has barely scratched the surface of racial equality in casting and crew, and is just as far from accurately and respectfully representing the LGBTQ+ community. In the 1940s, 50s, and 60s, gay characters were commonly angry, sad, suicidal, or murderous. One example of this is Alfred Hitchcock's movie Rope, 1948. This movie is about two men who are heavily hinted at to be gay and who commit a murder just for the fun of it.
Brandon, how did you feel?
When?
During it?
I don't know, really. I don't remember feeling very much of anything. Until his body went limp. And I knew it was over.
And then?
Then I felt tremendously exhilarated. How did you feel?
Daniel Mangan writes in his paper, College Course File, The History of Lesbian and Gays on Film, that they do so by means of a philosophy closely connected to the recent American enemy, the Nazis.
I think the representation of LGBTQ people in cinema, in American cinema, has changed over the decades. Up until the 1970s, they were mostly stereotypes, often deranged killers, or there were mincing stereotypes. There was a trope that the faggot always died in a lot of films. In the 80s, Hollywood made a couple LGBTQ films like Making Love and Personal Best and a comedy called Partners that tried to show more representation but didn't always do it in a very strong or positive light. Some were good, but not all. Then there was the New Queer Cinema movement, which happened in the 1990s, where a lot of filmmakers, angry at the AIDS crisis and other factors of representation, came out with a vengeance, let's say, and made a lot of films that showed angry queer, you know, people reacting to society. And those were very exciting films and generated a whole movement. Then we had a lull for a while where people were sort of complacent. Then you had a sort of a trend in the sort of 2000s where films like Boys Don't Cry and Milk came out and made, you know, queer visibility, especially for straight actors, popular again and award-winning. So it's shifting, you know.
Though it is improving, this dark stigma around homosexuals continues today, even if it is done more subtly or even subconsciously.
One of my grad students, I was very much in love with him.
Frank's first scene in Little Miss Sunshine is when he's hospitalized after a suicide attempt.
You fell in love with the boy?
Yes, I did. Very much so.
That's silly.
You're right. It was silly. It was very, very silly.
There's another word for it.
Dad.
The boy that I was in love with fell in love with another man, Larry Sugarman. What happened was 2 days ago, the MacArthur Foundation, in its infinite wisdom, awarded a genius grant to Larry Sugarman. And that's when I
decided to check out early.
Yes.
So you're getting your sense of humor back?
Yeah, they can't take that away from me.
Milo's first scene in The Skeleton Twins is his suicide attempt. While acknowledging the high suicide rate amongst gay and transgender people is definitely important, mental illness or depression are not side effects of homosexuality and shouldn't be treated as a given when it comes to members of the community. I also believe using failed suicides to propel an entire plot can be insensitive to the issue. It is imperative for LGBTQ+ people to see themselves in happy characters. Only being exposed to gay media with sad endings creates a stigma in gay people that they cannot really ever be happy or loved. Attempted and committed suicide rates are so high amongst LGBTQ+ youth because they are born into a world ready to tell them that one of the most basic things about them is wrong, dirty, disgusting, and sinful, as Cody Fern explains.
What gay shame does to a person, and that it's very different from all other kinds of shame, in that it's something that is forced into a person from the society and then is internalized by the person.
I watched something recently that I got so excited about. Oh, Sex Education. Mm-hmm.
Which, that show was awesome.
It was so good. But like, it sort of starts to explore like what is like repressed and internalized homophobia, yeah. Which I think is an interesting thing to explore, but I also feel like that it sets a precedent around abuse and like what does love look like in a queer context, yeah. In a way that to me feels really messed up. And I'm not sure what the target audience is for that show, but like I know that all my friends watched it And we loved it, and we were able to understand that that is messed up, like that was a complicated choice that they were making, but I don't know if when I was 15 I would have understood that. Mm-hmm. And I think that so oftentimes queer relationships are represented in the context of violence or abuse of some form, and so that to me feels really scary.
When queer cinema was coming out in the 90s and beyond, you always had coming out films.
I just don't want people getting the wrong idea.
What idea?
People think you're gay.
Is that what you want to know?
I mean, I think the film needs to tell the story that it needs to tell. So if that includes the coming out thing, which is a story that a lot of straight people, I feel like, want to know, and whether that's a part of it or not, it depends on the story.
And I think it's important to have that because people still need to have that message reinforced or that positive reinforcement. But I don't think that has to be the only story we tell. And I think that, to see a film about a character who's sort of happily adjusted in a relationship may be boring, but it's far more realistic. And, they always want to put the drama on the screen.
Characters that are LGBTQIA in film and media are represented as addicts or as depressed or suicidal. They're often, killed off early. It is a reality of a lived experience, but whether that needs to be a focus of media, I struggle with that because it becomes all of the focus. But at the same time, I'm not super interested in depictions of queer folks where it's all where we're denying the reality of what's happening in society. But that's kind of what a lot of media does with people in any way, is create unrealistic expectations.
Well, I think that, you get a lot of the gay white male films, and a lot of lesbian films are, not as strong as they could be because, the representation isn't there to the same degree. And that wasn't a factor of the filmmakers not being talented, because I love Jamie Babbitt's films, like But I'm a Cheerleader and The Quiet, and I really love, Lisa Cholodenko's films. High Art is fantastic, The Kids Are All Right, Laurel Canyon. But a lot of lesbian filmmakers don't get the money or the budget that the gay male filmmakers were getting back in the time when new queer cinema was happening. They could get grants. When that money dried up, those films stopped getting made. So it's not a question of we don't want this representation or people aren't interested in making films like this. It's we don't have the money. What's interesting is, when I was a teenager, I got to, I had to sneak and see queer movies, and that was always like, interesting because of what I could see and what I was allowed to see and what I did see. I think you have a much greater opportunity now to see all kinds of things. My favorite LGBTQ movie, maybe one of the first ones I saw, called Parting Glances, which was back in the 1980s, Bill Sherwood's only film. The main character is very much somebody who I aligned with, and it was one of the first films to deal with AIDS and the AIDS crisis in American cinema.
And Nick was dying of AIDS.
So it's kind of important in that. It wasn't the first, but it was one of the first. I really liked that film because it was the kind of film I saw when I was a teenager coming out. And so it was really important to me to see it.
It is so important for gay youth especially to be exposed to happy and hopeful content that they can relate to. Seeing people that one can resonate with on screen is important, but LGBTQ+ people deserve to see themselves in a positive light without homophobic undertones to their stories. It wasn't until Alex Strangelove and Love, Simon in 2018 that mainstream movies showed happy endings for gay teenage characters. 2019's Booksmart depicts a teenage queer woman and her attempts at romance. This is a subplot within the greater Superbad-esque film, but is very well done. And while these movies are not necessarily that fantastic or incredible in their stories, neither are the typical teen movies set in high schools with predictable resolutions and straight characters with boring personalities. Guilty pleasure teen movies have been around for decades, and now young gay people will finally have films in that genre that they can relate to.
So if I was a teenager and I went to see Love, Simon with my parents, it would be a chance to talk about it. Would I come out to my parents having seen that movie? Perhaps. I don't know, but at least it gives you the opportunity. My point about Love, Simon, and what I wrote when I reviewed it, is that the most interesting thing about him is that he's gay, and they make him so boring otherwise that he doesn't embrace his sexuality. It was sort of frustrating.
My name's Simon. For the most part, my life is totally normal. Nobody knows I'm gay.
Moonlight was a big deal. I think there's still a long way to go, but we're starting to make some really good inroads. It's just a shame that it's taken so long.
I mean, I think Moonlight, it's a great film, but it's tragic. I haven't seen Tangerine, because it's really sad. I feel like most of those films are really sad, and I tend to not want to watch films that are going to make me a puddle of tears. Representations of trans folks and non-binary folks in film. It's really hard to think of good films. Ones that I feel good about, I can't think of any that I feel really genuinely good about. But I think that seeing yourself represented helps to validate yourself and see yourself as a human being that matters and that has autonomy and that is a part of society. And when you don't see that, I think it's really hard to love yourself.
And I think a lot of these films give people the opportunity to talk about or create a conversation. But it's just great that we're having more opportunities, there's more diverse voices, because at the moment there's just, you know, not enough.
I mean, this is super cheesy, but I feel like when I did finally come out, a lot of it had to do with sort of being introduced to Riot Girl stuff and realizing that there was a queerness, that queerness existed. And that I could be queer and still have long hair, and that there were all sorts of ways that my gender and sexuality could be explored and expressed, but that just wasn't made available to me. I think it's extremely beneficial for people to see themselves reflected in media. So whether that's queerness or race or class, I think it's crucial. So definitely I think seeing representations of ourselves is important.
It's just great that we're having more opportunities, there's more diverse voices, because at the moment there's just, you know, not enough. And now that we have all these outlets on streaming sites and, you know, Vimeo and places like that, we have an opportunity to tell more stories. And I think the more stories we tell, the more people we can reach and show. We just want dignity and respect and, you know, the same rights as everyone else.